Non, mais je remets la justice.
So opposite to
you. What?
Yeah,
Michelle is his sister.
His sister, oh, that's pretty cool. Thank you for coming.
And this is he's the program organizer.
And with him?
And a poet.
And a poet. With him, yeah.
Co-editor. Yeah, an editor. Co-editor, right? You and Jill.
Yeah.
Thank you for coming to commemorate with us the 7th anniversary of the Haitian earthquake took place in January 12, 2010. I have prepared remarks about the event. You're gonna be with us throughout the evening until 1 o'clock, and we're gonna have John Ripton. We're gonna say thank you to John Ripton. He's one of the co-organizers of the of this event, and we have the photographers here with us. Steve Hansen is on the scene. He's from Dougal Division. Is the other photographer. And the third one is Dumafis Lafontaine from Aida Gallery, who's here with us and is a well-known Haitian cultural activist in the community. He doesn't like that term, but we call him a cultural activist. we have also with us the current poet laureate of Boston, and Daniel Logo George from Lesley University. She's here with us. You're going to hear poems, wonderful poems. And Patrick Sylvain is not here yet. He's a member of our collective. He's not here, Patrick Sylvain, yet. And we're going to have a medical report from Dr. Sturman Toussaint. He's in Haiti. We're going to have him to Skype. TV. And Charlot Lucien, coordinator of Haitian Artists Assembly of Massachusetts, who's here with us. We organize here every year now a Haitian Creole Month to celebrate the Haitian Creole language. We have, of course, our videographer, Walk Louis, with us. We have Fred Edson Lafortune, a poet who's going to be reading with us. He publishes in Trilingual Press. Jean-Denis Joachim, one of the organizers with Fred of the Haitian Creole Month. And I am Tonton Guy, the editor of Trilingual Press. We continue to honor and commemorate the memory of the January 10th, 2010 earthquake victims, because we don't want to forget this horrific day and the devastations and nightmares that followed it. as it should be, with survivors and descendants of major human tragedies, such as the extermination of the Native Americans, the transatlantic slavery, the Jewish Holocaust, the Hurricane Katrina, the memory of the horrendous nature and the suffering that they cause help sustain an active rejection of the malevolent appeal while articulating new ways of managing adversities and living with each other. After the Haitian earthquake, upon seeing the catastrophic damages he has caused and the human resilience and solidarity in dealing with it, I express the wish that Haiti will recover and rebuild on new and better foundations. Unfortunately, these new foundations have not materialized. Even before the earthquake, the socio-economic, ecologic, and sanitary conditions of Haiti were already seismic. And in many parts, people were living in unacceptable, subhuman conditions. The earthquake only exacerbated these trends. In the collective books, Tectonic Shifts, edited by Mark Scholler and published 2 years after the quake, one of the contributors, Anthony Oliver Smith, writes, I quote, "Disasters are not accidents or acts of God. They are deeply rooted in the social, economic, and environmental history of the societies where they occur. As such, disasters have historical roots. A disaster is made inevitable by the historically produced pattern of vulnerability evidence in location, infrastructure, socio-political structure, production patterns, and ideology that characterize a society," unquote. In the case of Haiti, the mere magnitude of victimization and damages caused by the quake indicate a pre-existed vulnerability due to many factors and causes. For one, as Oliver Smith says, and I quote, "African slavery is the foundational element in the long-term constructions of Haiti's vulnerability," unquote. Naturally, there are also the hostile action taken by great powers like France, Spain, Britain, Great Britain, Germany, United States, to contain what they considered like the pervasive influence of the Haitian Revolution. Chief among those actions were the international embargo decreed against Haiti, against the Young Nation, just same year Haiti decided that embargo, total embargo, no commerce with Haiti. Almost all the great powers participated in that embargo, except Denmark, the Netherlands, and the Vatican. But almost all of the powers kept the embargo against Haiti. Okay, also, there's also the recognition payment the French king, Louis the X, he came to power during the restoration in France. He imposed on Haiti under the threat of invasion in 1825. They came to the Haitian seaport, and you see the battlefields. And they said they will invade if Haiti doesn't pay. The debt, I was explaining that earlier, is the so-called debt of recognition. They said, well, the colon, the former slave owners who left the country because of the Haitian Revolution, they lost their wealth. So therefore, the Haitian must pay for it. Haiti continued to pay that debt until 1947. The French passed the payment of that debt to the Americans in 1915 when they invaded Haiti. They occupied Haiti for 19 years. So, regarding the earthquakes, human causality, let's quote another contributor to the book Tectonic Shift, Yolette Etienne, who makes the following observation. I quote, "The extent of the earthquake damage can be explained by a long and deep structural crisis. Port-au-Prince, a city built for 250,000 people, had 3 million people on January 12, 2010, with population densities close to those of Calcutta and Mumbai. The territorial layout inherited from the 1915 model of the hyper-concentration around Port-au-Prince, both resulting from the 19-year occupation, is to a large extent responsible for the casualties Haiti suffered during the earthquake." So, to remedy to what you call a permanent structural and multilateral crisis, Yolande Etienne suggests the promotion of new model that will challenge the centralization, exclusion, polarization, financial speculation, and the extreme dependence that characterized Haiti during the last 50 years, unquote. So, finally, let's finish with this observation. The recent devastation of Hurricane Matthew in the southwestern part of the country is one of a series of catastrophes that highlight Haiti's vulnerability to natural disasters due to poor, neglected infrastructure and inadequate preparation to crisis response by the authorities. In this sense, Haiti's persistent humanitarian crisis is fundamentally unnatural. Despite the setback in the current Haiti's trend of manufacturing presidents through the manipulation and control of the electoral machinery, with support of the financial sectors and the so-called international community, I remain hopeful that Haiti will one day use again, as she had done in the past, the very adversities history has thrust upon her as means to her liberation and recovery. For that, we will need a new way of managing our biopolitics and planning our future. Thank you for coming to celebrate with us. For now, I will introduce Jill Nations. She's going to be a co-MC. I'm going to introduce her, and she's going to be introducing the other people. Jill Nechensky. Was born in the USA, poet, literary critic, and educator. She wrote a PhD thesis on slaves' narrative in Cuba and Latin America. She's the recipient of a research grant from the Miller Foundation and a former fellow of the W.E.B. Du Bois Institute for Afro-American Research at Harvard University. She is currently a bilingual editor and the English editor of Trilingual Press. Please welcome Jill Nechensky.
Thank you, Tonton Guy. Thank you all for coming here on your Saturday. I'm Jill Nechensky. And since we have quite a roster of wonderful speakers, I'm going to try to make it quick and a little bit play the role as what my old professor used to call el látigo, the whip. In other words, short time, short speeches. It's very hard. I know the temptation, but we're going to give short speeches because we have a lot of people. So right away, I would like to introduce a gentleman who was not only one of the photographers of this wonderful exhibit we have outside, but also one of the organizers of this event, planted its very seed 2 years ago, John Ripton. John Ripton is a PhD in history from Columbia University. We are lucky to have him as an historian, professor, and I'd like to say a visionary. We met about 2 years ago in a Somerville coffee shop, and in that wonderful meeting, the idea of a poetry and photography exhibit about Haiti and commemorating the earthquake came up. At that time, we thought of doing it in New York City. We talked about it and talked about it. In the meantime, John moved to Maine. Many things happened, and we brought him to see the smallest museum in the world, which is in Somerville, Massachusetts. I'm very glad to know him, and I would just like to say, please come on up and say a few words. John Ripton of Portland, Maine.
Thank you, Jill. It's just great to be here. I know very little, to be honest with you, about the Haitian community in Boston, but what I do know has certainly been very impressive, knowing Tonton Guy and Jill, meeting Dumafis, and all the other people that I've met this morning whose names I can't recall at the moment. But I want to say that it has been a pleasure working with them, and I hope to continue to work with them. I visited Haiti once. I'm going to quickly get off, but I completely agree with what Tonton Guy had to say. It is an unnatural disaster, and I'll just say one thing about it. When I was there, it was very clear that bribes were a major factor in the destruction of the city of Port-au-Prince. I hope I say that closely enough. Because due to those bribes, more sand was used than cement in these buildings. So this is just a detail. It's not minor. It's a detail of how this earthquake was an unnatural disaster. And historically, Tonton Guy was right on. I'm doing research now on this, and I see that every time there is a natural disaster, very few. I've been doing research from 750 to 1150 to 1750, trying to track civilizations and global civilizations. And every time there is a natural disaster, they are not prepared. They contribute to that disaster in many ways, and Haiti is the country that really ought to be on everybody's agenda in terms of how you can turn around a country that is so divided by class, where 1% of the people have 50% of the wealth. How can that be? That's not sustainable. It's obvious that people suffer from that, and I'll leave it there. I want to mention Steve Arneson in the back here, and Dumafis. Where are you, Dumafis? There he is back there. How could I miss him? the hat. And thank them for helping a great deal, and Jill and Tonton Guy, of course. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Can you introduce Steve?
I will.
Thank you. I didn't know that I was to do that. I thought you were going to do it. Steve Arneson's a good friend of mine, and we've worked together on a number of different projects, art projects in the past, and maybe some photography projects. I'm not sure about that. Steve is vice president for development and sales at Dugal Visual Solutions in New York City, one of the top graphic producers, I should say. He'll tell you more about that. He grew up in Haiti. He came to school to Hampshire College, left Left Hampshire College after about a semester. Went to New York City, told his parents he's going to make it as a photographer. Started doing prints for museums in the city, for photographers who were exhibiting in the city. He spent much of his youth in Haiti and did a lot of the photography you see out there. The first four, five, six photographs are from the 1980s. And he's a superb photographer who's hidden, who has to get out there and show his work. I've told him that a million times. And Steve, just come up and say a little bit about Dugal and about yourself.
Thank you, John, for the introduction, and thank you to Trilingual Press and Totongi and Dumafis for inviting me to participate in this exhibit. I'm very honored to be a part of it. As John mentioned, I actually spent a year in Haiti. Not my childhood, but my younger brother and sister grew up in Haiti. They went to school there, and my father worked in Haiti as the director of the OAS for many years, and so my family's lived there, and my mother is currently still living in Haiti today. So she was there during the earthquake, and I'm truly honored to be here to be a witness and then to raise consciousness for all those who perished in the earthquake in Haiti, and support the Haitian community in arts, poetry, and really an honor to be here. My company, Dugal Visual Solutions in New York City, has a foundation called the Big Picture Foundation, and we support a lot of artists group and efforts like this, and we were able to help out and make the photo exhibit come alive. Thank you very much.
Dumafis Lafontaine was born in Haiti. He's a political cultural activist who's been working many years to effect change in Haiti. Photographer and poet, he is the author of a collection of photos on the Haiti's earthquake title After the Dust Settled, published in 2011. By Trilingual Press. His latest collection of bilingual poems, Krikrak, Deyemon Geyemon, Mountains Behind Mountains, was published by Trilingual Press. Dumafis is the director of Haiti Gallery. Please let's welcome Dumafis Lafontaine.
Merci, Tonton Guy. Honneur, respect, c'est un plaisir pour moi avec nous. I'm really delighted to be here. I'm an amateur photographer. I'd like to thank Tonton Guy, Jill, John, and Anis for allowing me to participate in this photo exhibit. And most of all, thank you for you being here. What I'd like to say is, besides the structural issues that Haiti face, there is a question that those of us who subscribe to the Haitian school or L'École Merveilleuse ask is, whether we should change or improve the historical legacy and tradition of Haiti. And you'll know that the international community has chosen to change or the option of changing what I consider life in Haiti. So, for example, moving the country away from agriculture to pretty much sweatshops. But for us, we think that it's better to improve the Haitian lives, and we do so through education, or rather, studies. So I just want you to know that there is such a thing called the Haitian school, or l'école merveilleuse, that Jacques-Stéphane Alexis articulated. And as I mentioned before, it's just a matter of engaging in research, longitudinal research, or looking at the problems of Haiti from a system dynamics approach. And so for instance, we now talking about a Haitian generation. That is, we're looking at Haitians born in 2016, projecting ahead to 241. So that means we should be preparing the future of those young people born, those babies born in 2016, who will be 25 in 2041. So our approach is very simple. We look at that's how we look at it. So we can talk more about this. I'll just say that those photos that are exhibited out there were printed in a white paper that I published upon my return from visiting Haiti in February 2010. And as Tonton Guy mentioned, the white paper is published by Trilingual Press. Tonton Guy has been a mentor, a model. What can I say about Tonton Guy? So please give yourselves a round of applause for being here with us. Thank you.
I have the honor now of beginning the poetry portion of the program. And the first person I'm going to present is Daniel Legros-Georges. Daniel Legros-Georges was born in Haiti and raised in the United States. A poet, a professor of literature at Lesley University, a kind spirit. She is also the current Poet Laureate of Boston, which is, a four-year, oh my goodness. She is the eternal Poet Laureate of Boston as well. Her poems have appeared in many reviews and anthologies, including American Poetry Review, The Caribbean Writer. Her latest book is called The Dear Remote Nearness of You, published by Barrow Street Press. And I'd like to say that as Poet Laureate, I have seen Danielle involved with everything from sidewalk poetry in the many languages of Boston, and the important work, more important now than ever, I might say, of civic engagement and culture for all. I give you Danielle Georges.
Good morning. Honneur. I love this Haitian greeting of honor, which is responded to with respect. So, honneur.
All right, thank you. Thank you, organizers, Tonton Guy, John, Jill, for this important commemoration. I'm gonna read a few poems. Many of you are aware that in 2013, Dominicans of Haitian descent in the Dominican Republic were stripped of their citizenship by the Dominican Constitutional Court. So that's one of the many challenges we face as Haitians in the world. And I just wanted to just read this poem as part of a consciousness-raising effort around what our brothers and sisters are dealing with in the Dominican Republic. A Dominican poem. If you are born and you are stateless, if you are born and you are homeless, if your state and home are not yours, and yet everything you know, what are you? Who are you? And who am I without the dark fields I walk upon, the streets I know, the blue corners I call mine, the ones you call yours? Who am I to call myself citizen and human and free? And who are you to call yourself landed and grounded and free? And who is judge enough? Who citizen enough? Who native? Who other? Who are we who move so freely without accents of identification, without skin of identification, with all manner of identification, with gold seals of approval, with stamps of good fortune, with the accident of blameless birth? Who are we to be so lucky? And I'll read three poems about the earthquake. This is entitled In the Next Town. What about such gravity makes us want to live? Pulled from the rubble, a woman in ash. A boy who carries his broken-armed sister down a hill. What in us says life? Life. Life after 20 days entombed. Life in the singing at the door, not even a door, the remains, the imprint of a church. The Lord somehow, Jesus somehow, Mother Mary somehow, all the God's descendant, the gate, the crossroads, and the light. How does a country bury its too hastily buried dead? This poem is entitled Poem for the Poorest Country in the Western Hemisphere. As I was watching the effects of the earthquake here in the United States, I was in Florida at the time, as we all were, I imagine, watching it. I kept hearing Haiti referred to as the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere. It was constantly being repeated in the mainstream news. I found it problematic because while Haiti does indeed struggle with poverty, Haiti is so much more than its poverty. I know Haiti to contain, you know, some of the most beautiful people, the most beautiful sites in the world, and I've traveled quite a bit. So there's and it's a beautiful site for art
and it's just, I love Haiti, obviously. I felt I had to take on this moniker, this last name that Haiti had seemed to have acquired in the press, in the Western press. Poem for the poorest country in the Western Hemisphere. Oh, poorest country, this is not your name. You should be called beacon. You should be called flame. Almond and bougainvillea. Garden and green mountain. Villa and hut. Girl with red ribbons in her hair. Books under arm, charmed by the light of morning. Charcoal seller in black skirt, encircled by dead trees. You, country, are the merchant woman and the eager young clerk, the grandfather at the gate, at the crossroads, with the flashlight, with everything in sight. Actually, I'm going to read two more. One, not having to do with the earthquake, actually, has to do with my grandmother. I grew up here in Boston, and my grandmother would force me to accompany her to do her shopping at Haymarket. Some of you are familiar with Haymarket. It's this outdoor market in near Faneuil Hall, actually, where she would get her produce and her live chicken, of course, right? And and she would take this poor creature, which she would purchase the poor creature, and take the poor creature, and put it in a pillowcase, and then she would we would get on the subway. On the red line to get back to Mattapan, right, where the Haitians live. and I was trying to be very cool all the while this transport thing was taking place before the inevitable occurred. This is called Boston Backyard. The image of the headless hen depends on the ring. My grandmother puts her hands on the thing, is ginger. A simple dust rises from the yard. We had been playing too long inside and escaped to the porch. She had not meant us to see the white feathers pinking, the twisting this way and that of the bird, the tree as it threatened the racer. My grandmother wipes her hands on her apron, which is blue with white buttons, and touches the dust to pick up the hen. She speaks but two words, which are soft to the bird and to the wind. She sends one word of thanks. And I will close with this poem entitled Intersection. And I wrote it shortly after the earthquake. I was asked to submit a poem to a book, the proceeds of which would support relief efforts. And I found that I had a hard time writing the poem, because how could I? I was struck by the loss of life, the scale of the loss of life. Also the understanding that many of those lives could have been saved had it not been for structural violence, which has been referred to by Tonton Guy and others, you know, overcrowding in Port-au-Prince, poverty, compromised government, international intervention in Haitian governmental affairs. And so how could I incorporate that all into one poem? And I found that I couldn't. So this is the poem that emerged out of that that request. Intersection. The earth shook. A portal opened. I walked through it. The earth shook. A portal opened. I walked through it. The earth shook. A portal opened. I walked through it. The earth shook. A portal opened. I walked through it. The earth shook. A portal opened. I walked through it. Earth. The earth shook. A portal opened. I walked through it. Ash. The earth shook. A portal opened. I walked through it. I walked through it. I walked through it. The earth shook. A portal opened. I walked through it. Earth. The earth shook. A portal opened. I walked through it. Ash. Ash. The earth shook. A portal opens. I walk through it. The earth shook. A portal opens. I walk through it.
Thank you so much, Danya. It gives me great pleasure now to introduce our next poet, Patrick Sylvain. Patrick is born in Haiti, a poet and educator, is the author of many Creole and English poetry books and stories, including the recent Masuife, a collection of poems, and Anbabot Kwokodil, a historic novel in Haitian Creole, recently released by Trilingual Press. And I believe we have it on our book table. Patrick Sylvain has been a professor of Haitian Creole in Harvard University and Brown University, and is currently working on a PhD at Brandeis University. And I don't want to take away his time, so Patrick.
Thank you very much. Thank you for organizing this. And thank you, Danielle, for your work. And the last poem, even though I've read it with you, I've read it several times, I've heard it several times, each time it has major impact on me. I'm gonna read a very short poem for Fidel Castro. Because Cuba has done so much for Haiti, so much for healthcare that people don't talk about. So it's a haiku, it's very small. Fidel. There is a cane cutter in Fidel's soft, graying beard, chopping bitter roots. Atlantic souls. In the depths of the Atlantic, there are ethereal graveyards where crossroads are anchored by bleached bones, silver swords, gold coins, and iron chains unable to courtship the darkness of the Leviathan. I close my eyes.
to hear an orchestra of waves battering, honeycomb like rocks on the edge of land. This is where sterns incessantly slice waves, bringing in bound feet, the bulk of tattered beings salted and assaulted to nothingness. I am a vessel, unseen, sailing through night's wet curtain, and comfortable beyond the brim of light. Wind stirs me homeward to latitude zero, where I hear the songs of the unnumbered and the unbaptized. Sometimes I take to the sky with outcast seagulls, venting pain with distress shrieks, grieving drowned musical hearts, singing to the goddesses of the sea, pleading for the breaking of Leviathan's lingering trade of coastal mariners. In the depths of the Atlantic, there are ethereal graveyards, clusters of intertwined families humming in the confinement of the sea. Through gaunt hopes, their quiescent souls channel their ancestral phoenix, flecks of flames. This poem this moment is really tough for me because not only is it the 7th anniversary of the earthquake, but it's also the 7th anniversary of when we lost our first unborn child. My wife was pregnant. On the 12th, I was supposed to have gone to Haiti, and she had pain, and I canceled my flight. The hotel that I was supposed to stay at was one of the hotels that destroyed. And at 4:53, when we got the call, she was cooking, and she felt pain. And that night, we went to the hospital. The next day, we had to have an operation. We lost the baby. So I was really going through difficulties, and of course, I lost a cousin and other relatives, and my childhood home also got destroyed. Ports of sorrow. Early January afternoon, I stand in my own port of pain, intertwined with my wife as we mourn death like an incision to the core. Bob notes in the soprano's throat, Port-au-Prince has become an archipelago of open tombs, consumed slowly by the sun and forming an everlasting covenant. Their unrelenting port is a cup of their blood. May the sins of the prince be forgiven and forgive those who have trespassed against the wretched of the earth. The port of Prince is a mausoleum of dirt embroidered bodies, a quarry of dried tongues begging for holy water and bread. No bread was ever broken, and the disciples feared the masses. Port-au-Prince has neither port nor prince, but satellites beam our misery as we line up, wounded, broken, seeking shelter anywhere but home. There's no anchor for anger and no anchor for despair. The prince departed centuries ago with our coffer, leaving but broken chariots and cobwebs treasures. The port of Prince is a mausoleum of dirt embroidered bodies. I wake at night, shuddering and intertwined with my wife in our own port of pain. The clock does not stop at our will. And how I wish to turn the hand of time, changing the prince's morbid cloak,
but our ill-constructed port mimicked our timid steps and breath. The departed last gulp of air is its breath, the relay of life. Port-au-Prince has neither port nor prince, as tempests incessantly sweep through 1804, bright filament becomes faint and sad, dimming like a dying firefly. Like life mocks us with sadistic laughter, I feel congested with death, losses, and corpses swarming in my chest. I need a stronger port to anchor their souls. I'll read one more poem, last one. I guess it's a continuation of talking to this poem, and I wrote it yesterday, so bear with me. So you know how poets are constantly editing. I may edit it while I'm reading it. Tolls taken. Having teary eyes while peeling an onion is not crying. No fuse is broken in the brain. No wires spark without a circuit breaker. An onion can be dropped, moved away from, one's hands washed. The onions sizzle in a pan and then feasted upon. My regrets and pains are skin grafted. I was in New England when I got punched, knocked down with the searing news, the shaking and crumbling of bellies. One, a tectonic plate, the other, a uterus, both deadly. January in New England, the earth stone cold, hearts buried under layers of fabric, warming of viscous fluids inside of red chambers. But today, a premature heart could no longer throb inside the warm amniotic sac. Today, where summer is permanent, tectonic plates made autumn come and shook thousands of leaves falling like monarch butterflies. There was no time for migration. I am a tropical islander by birth and not a New Englander, but I have grown to admire the changing of seasons while driving through red, yellow, purple, brown, and even green leaves. Leaf flights excite the shutter of my camera, echo metamorphosis, digitally engrave on megabytes, only to be retrieved for nostalgia of memory, for aesthetics. In these woods, falling autumn leaves are swinging doors of life and death. But in the tropics, falling leaves surely marks the end of a process, a time marked by death. January tears shed, onions hang around my being like two permanent ghosts. I cut the rings and hope each year will diminish the tears awakened by the knife of time. Thank you.
Charlot also is the coordinator of Haitian Artists Assembly of Massachusetts, and he's brought artworks with him. He is a painter as well, and he works with the collective of artists and Jacques Mel that we just mentioned. And Charlot would like to speak a few words about the paintings. And after Charlot, we may be able to reconnect with the help of the staff here at the library with Dr. Toussaint. And if not, we'll go on to Haitian poetry with Fred Edson Lafortune. So, Charlot, it's a long trek.
Bonsoir. Good afternoon. Thank you for being here again. I would start this way. For those of you who might be of the younger generation, I put down this. I was mentioned as a painter. I barely paint. That happens maybe once or twice a year. So this latest piece here, just to bring your attention to it, I'm going back to 1980, something that used to be standard mainstream language. It used to be called 4-H. Anyone here can guess what that used to mean back in the days? That's what I and many Haitians grew up learning and repeating. 4 H's. Okay, not that surprising. Back in the days, it was called hemophiliac, heroin, homosexuals, and Haitians. That was the naming back in the days for what is called today as AIDS. Again, I repeat, that was mainstream standard language used in mainstream newspapers, media, as well in some quarters of the scientific community. That was in 1980. We are talking about earthquake that would be in 2010, and those of you again who might not know, earthquake happened on January 12, 2010, and in October of the same year, 2010, a cholera epidemic started in Haiti. After some research, it was discovered that came from the United Nations mission that was in the central plateau of Haiti. For 5 years, the United Nations consistently, systematically denied their role in the cholera epidemic in Haiti that has by then killed more than 8,000 people and contaminated about 80,000 to 90,000. So I am pointing this out because we also want art and culture to be an agent and vector of change. About 2 weeks ago, formally, the UN Secretary Ban Ki-moon formally apologized to the Haitian people about the role of the UN in the cholera epidemic and committed supposedly $400 million to A, compensate people who've been victims of the epidemic, and then B, try to rebuild infrastructure in Haiti to prevent this from happening anymore. Will the $400 million committed be disbursed? If we go back to what happened after the earthquake, where supposedly some $12 billion were supposed to be committed and disbursed for the reconstruction of Haiti, it did not happen. So as we speak now again, we remain skeptical and we keep pointing this out, that the weight of this virus has been as heavy as the weight of slavery on the neck of Haitians, on the necks of many other disfranchised community. So when I say I paint once a year, that would be my latest painting for both World AIDS Day, December 1, and the recognition by the UN of the cholera epidemic. Now let's go outside. What you'll see on one table here are artworks from artists here in Massachusetts and artists from the town of Jacmel in Haiti. Jacmel was the third, well, the city that was hit to a lesser extent during the earthquake, the first one being Port-au-Prince, the second one being Léogâne, and the third one being Jacmel. Now, Jacmel is also known as a Haitian cultural and historical landmark. Historical landmark, why? Because when Miranda and Bolivar fled Venezuela and found asylum in Haiti to get both weapons and 1,500 volunteers to go back to Venezuela and fight the independence war, the Venezuelan flag was literally created in Haiti. So Jacmel is known as a historical city. Also known as a historical city because we said from Port-au-Prince and Cap-Haïtien, that's where you find the largest pool of Haitian artists of all inspiration and style. We are talking about both so-called naive and primitive painting, as well as sophisticated type of painting that would fall on the either magic realism or either l'école de la beauté, the school of aesthetic. So I had a chance to visit Jacmel in 2003, and then right after the earthquake, knowing that the artist would have been affected, went back to visit in May 2010 with my friend Orest. Now we found that those artists were totally devastated, and they shared with us that because the city, which is also a touristic city, was destroyed, there was no more market to really get their artworks out. Second, they've either lost their houses or they've lost their art supplies. So out of the meeting came out the idea. What if we come back here in New England, are able to raise some funds or get you some supplies, and then send you back some of those supplies? Would you paint? It was an overwhelming response. So the same year, those artists started to paint, and we traveled to bring back their artworks. But what did we find back then? Paintings of broken roads, destroyed bodies, destroyed landscapes, the total reflection of the devastation that they experienced during the earthquake. So you will see a couple of paintings that I brought as sample of their artwork that are labeled 2010. At the same time here in Massachusetts, artists were also painting their evocation, their understanding of the devastation. So you'll find outside one painting of a woman who's blooming the streets. But what you may not fully see, which is part of a series of painting, is that some of the dust and the rocks are also coming out of her body. So the interpretation of this artist is that those women were blooming not only the debris from the streets of Port-au-Prince, but also the emotional debris that the earthquake had brought into their person. So again, powerful artwork that symbolically express literally what people were doing and emotionally what they were doing. One of my pieces also that I brought painted here had to do with this child hiding behind this door that is riddled with bullet holes and close to the debris on the floor with a red white flag titled, "Can I Come Out and Play?" That was my sense that in Haiti those kids could not come out and play, both because of the earthquake and because of the unstable and violent political situation. I put last on the table a painting that's dated 2011. Now between 2010 and when we went back in 2011, those artists who have received the supplies, which came to be as symbol of hope, started to paint what has been part of their traditional inspiration. The marketplaces, people going to their businesses, the beautiful and superb landscapes of Jacmel of Haiti. So between year one up to now, there has been an evolution or a shift in the focus of their artwork to move from the emotional trauma experience from the earthquake to something brighter, to a sense of normalcy. One of the reasons why we'll be able to sustain this artwork is because of the collaboration of all of our partners here, but especially of William James College in Newton, because which used to be the Massachusetts School of Professional social psychology. They were intrigued, they were interested to follow the evolution of people who were hit by the earthquake, who've experienced trauma in their bodies, in their soul, in their homes, and then how over time they will keep painting. Now, here is a big shift that took place in 2013. Some of the children of those artists got interested into what their dad, uncle, or mother were doing. Some women also got interested into this. So in 2013, we were able to get a cohort of about 60 children to start painting under the guidance or mentoring of four or five of those older artists. So as a result, we have to now buy more of those things and then ship them both for the adult artists and for the younger crowd. So what we've seen, we worked out a system by which whenever a painting is sold here in Boston, we send them 75% of the proceeds, and we keep 25%, which we use to buy frames, to buy those supplies, or to pay for the shipping of the supplies. So I came here with a very specific and clear purpose, both sharing this piece of information with you. Second, invite you to look at those paintings and have a sense of what they represent. And to tell you, there is information on the table, phone number, business card, or there's even a box, or I can even pull my hat and put it here. Whatever you give, it's the symbolism of the gesture that will count. Whether you put one single dollar, 25 cents, or $50, is the symbolism of the gesture. We will report that out of this event, we were able to collect $15, $500. The whole idea of this collaboration with artists in Jacmel came out of the earthquake. So we want every single year to continue telling people support, or most importantly, buy the artwork, or most importantly, whenever you have a chance for your wedding, family reunion, take the joy of visiting Jacmel, Haiti. Thank you very much.
Now I'm going to present Jean-Denis Joachim. Actually, they're going to have a combined presentation. Jean-Denis Joachim and Fred Edson Lafortune together. Jean-Denis Joachim is the coordinator of Dunset Poetry Series at Bunker Hill Community College for more than a decade now. He's been the animator of City Nights Readings Series since 2001. Joachim has published in many anthologies and magazines. His latest books include Cross Road, Chemin Croisé, a bilingual collection of poems, and Quartier, published by Jepka Editions. Our editor is here, Roosevelt Deronville, one of the organizers of Moi Creole Haïtien in Massachusetts. Jean-Denis Joachim is a former poet, populist of Cambridge, Massachusetts. Now, Fred Edson Lafortune was born in Haiti. He lives now in Rhode Island, Providence, Rhode Island. He writes in Haitian, French, and English. He is the founder of the cultural organization Eco Culture in Rhode Island, USA. He is the animator of a cultural program on Radio VCH, Voice of the Haitian Community in Rhode Island. His books include the collection of poems En à l'asile, published by Trilingual Press, and Silex, published recently by Jepka Editions. Please, let's welcome Fred Jean-Denis Joachim and Fred Edson Lafortune. Thank you.
Jesus.
We are joined by Lorraine and Lovell Cadet. Lovell Cadet is a master drummer and a composer from the southern part of the country. We are presenting to you today a lamentation, part of a longer piece that was written after the earthquake. It's an excerpt of it in the voice of people abroad, and to present it to people outside of the country. We'll also finish with a celebratory rhythm from the southern part of the country, from Lekai, that is called C'est tombé dans can. Because yes, it is true, we must do, and we have to do what we're doing today to never forget what happened, to keep walking, to prevent it to happen in the same way, and also to keep lending our hands to say thank you to the people, all the countries, all the individuals who came in support to help us. So for all these reasons, we have to keep doing that. And now, please enjoy this.
Espanté dans un coup de zèque 35 secondes. Qui l'est lié, papa bon Dieu? kod ke not mwen kase, van la tremblat jete m lot bo pas. Nan ba bouket la vi sans atan. Gloje m pedi pie nan kap l'espérans. Ki lè liye, papa bonzie? Je paye m pran kounel pa kouri de l'eau. Mèmman, pareilman, tout voie dépaman. La famille pas semblée pour dernier prier. Projet étranger, l'autre pile sous pile. Qui l'a le fou qui est papa bon Dieu?
Il est lié, papa bon Dieu. Il est lié. Il est lié.
Petit nom, wele wele, wele wele, tout moun mêlé. mon mélange dans la gratitude, tout qui est cassé et galigo. Qui est lié, papa, mon Dieu? Grâce! Grâce, s'il vous plaît! Grâce! Qui est lié? Qui est lié, papa, mon Dieu? Qui est lié, papa, mon Dieu? Qui est lié? Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dire un mot. Soleil la chita sous tête pays. Soleil la chita sous tête. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dire un mot. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dire un mot. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dire un mot. L'étendait tout détail secret, la gardé toute faux couzo. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dire un mot. C'est les après-midi tristes. C'est les après-midi. C'est les après-midi tristes. Le soleil là a couché trop vite. Et puis tout. La lina. Étoiles yo misé tout paraît. Tout ça en café. Tout ça en café. C'est mourir pour le moins. Jour de mes rêves. Soleil a couché sous tel pays a sans dire un mot. Soleil a chita sous tel pays a. Soleil a chita sous tel pays a sans dire un mot. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a des gourmets solo. Soleil la chita sous tête pays.
Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dire un mot. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dire un mot. Tout zèbre levé dans sable. La pluie tombée dans flamme soleil. Malais paraît sans signal. L'argent drivé dans la boue. L'argent entré dans salon. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dire un mot. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dire un mot. Si mon malade couché sans traitement. L'homme crié sans raison. Petite fille sans papa. La ligne perdit pli. La vie a fait salver. personne n'a pas demandé de clément. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dit yon mot. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dit yon mot. Cloche Saint-Anne pas sonné, cathédrale plate à tête. Sacré cœur fait du vol, tout les mélanger. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dit yon mot. Soleil la chita sous tête pays a sans dit yon mot. Port-au-Prince. Pète la mémoire, Podolphan, pack en pack, cimetière contre la gourmet, la vie a privaillé dans des comptes, soleil la chita sous tête pays à Saint-Denis.
Soleil la chita sous tête pays à.
Chrétien bouquet ou les graines chapelet.
Soleil la chita sous tête pays à Saint-Dion. Élection faite, l'idée faite. Les autres passés, les autres diplomatiques pour les biens de la patrie. Soleil la chita sous tête pays à Saint-Dion.
Soleil la chita sous tête pays à Saint-Dion. Candidat dansé, yo-yo. Privé, Piret, Philippe, en bas côte, engagement cassé, bout en bout, négociation, ambassade, tout vous tourne dos.
Soleil la chita sous tête pays. Soleil la chita sous tête pays. La police c'est petite soye. Yo celle qui périt dans la sécurité, dans l'insécurité bobine. Soleil la chita sous tête pays. Soleil la chita sous tête pays, sans dire non.
Soleil la chita sous tête pays, sans dire yon mot. La patrie engagée, tout le monde va dire journée, voisin tourne commandé, tout rêve de même mieux s'y fouquer.
Soleil la chita sous tête pays, soleil la chita sous tête pays, soleil la chita sous tête pays.
Tambour.
I'm going to read a poem. I'm going to read two poems, one in Creole, one in English. First, the Creole one. Gudu gudu padus nidu. Gudu gudu is the name given to the earthquake by the Haitian people. They say gudu gudu because of the vibration coming out underneath the house. Gudum, gudum, gudum. So they call the earthquake gudu gudu. Gudu gudu padus nidu. Grâce l'irée tes soupeaux, sous couler jam quand canin, sous Jean li défigure la vie, sous Jean li col bosso l'avenir. Grâce l'irée tes nan kè, nan de l'eau, j'ai une maman qui beaucoup croit ça qui rive et qui perdit beau sol qui joue, qui l'ennuie ni matin. Grâce l'irée tes nan camp sans abri, en battant qui pas caponner la pluie. Dans des espoirs sous yeux familiaux, même si ou te weyo de loin. Des as, c'est membrane la vie, pas de point, papé dit s'allier. Même après goudou goudou la itel, après même l'espoir te vle de la laï. Goudou goudou, c'est celle du mouvement, un petit moment dans firmament qui de chalboré s'entraille Haïti Thomas. Mais c'est tout, bien heureusement, lumière qui éclairait la voix Miola, même dans l'enfer, mal cité, mal à quoi. Disseyou, l'engouffre sans souffle, t'entends de malais qui pas jamais stoppé, cauchemar multiplié par millions passe. Mais c'est tout, éclairage dans fait noir. Tinel qui menait dans clarté soleil. Calbas cap voltigé sous la pluie belle, mal pour honte qui n'en gêne, dernier coup qui pas privé, tiré coucou. Goudou goudou pas douce ni doux, mais elle fait songer, belleté avant la colonie. Les pattes épaillées, même petit poulet, nazé, mais elle pas de cablier, l'idée pour faire des boisements, dans le cerveau colonisé, sous parole. Goudou goudou détruit ça que t'es construit, ensemble avec ça méchant t'es négligé. Enfer déraciné malfectati. Goudou goudou c'est un gros trou la terre. Enfer rempli belle promesse la nati. Goudou goudou pas te connaît. Sayo li décalé ni sayo lié paillé. Li chante libéra minusta, en bas épidémie maladie choléra. Même les li aide Eli Mateli, président d'Haïti en bas chambre. Même les à l'aide cléonnage mass media, li fait passer supporter Panzouris pour sauver, en bas macaca populace abusé. Goudou goudou, pas douce ni doux, pour maman qui perdit petite li, ak mari, de casquillé dans la fosse commune, ni pour Tita qui n'a mis tant désespoir, espérer tourner roche qui n'a pas gain sentiment, au lieu si longtemps mal cité en battante. Goudou goudou, pas douce ni doux, militer forcé en grandement au grand jour, de démasquer la Mayotte en bas boîte, pousser charogne dans la route sans honte, l'ouvrir barrière, frontière pour dictateur. Nommé néocolon, nouveau gouverneur. En bas bravo, député j'approuve dans l'ONU. Goudou goudou, c'est marque l'histoire. Mettez dans conscience tout petit Haïti Thomas. L'exemple de Constant Braille et Malais pour lever flambeau. Oh, Nam Guinée, pour libérer notre Thomas dans Macaca. Koué, bien 200 ans dans l'Amazonie. Oh, this last poem is an English poem I wrote. The night, this actually was the very night of the election of Trump. And I had a sense that election creates some kind of, you know, nightmarish. It was the materialization of the nightmarish scenario. And a lot of people were feeling down. And I stay up that night, and I wrote, I take my pen, I wrote that poem. Yeah, straight in English, I wrote it in that night. I call it a word of wisdom to the disappointed Hillary voters. That was the previous title, but I changed the title. A word of wisdom to the disappointed voters. After the glory days of 1789, came Napoleon, the butcher of freedom. Then came the restoration of the ancien regime. After the parricide of the Pont Rouge in Haiti, came 200 years of oppression. Then the hope of a better tomorrow. After the valorous struggle and the sacrifice consented by Tubman, Brown, Douglas, and Lincoln to elevate our living together to our higher aims and decency, came post-Reconstruction with its Jim Crow horrors. After King's dreams and Malcolm's defiance comes today, the nightmare of Trump and leading us to the abyss of hate. Thus, the circle continues, but hope still remains alive. History is a long journey of unknown turns. Trump is today our turning challenge. The cries for hatred, exclusion, and lynching will have passed as an aberration of the soul if we counter them with our collective will to building a better life and a wonder of being. The Trumps and the Le Pens of our world are symptoms of expected madness to come. Our endeavor is a betting on what is best in all of us. Nightmares come and go until the day brightens, the day to rejoice of our shared lives goes on. A democratic state, a democratic election can go right or left, but the struggle for a better world is an ongoing pursuit. Our aspiration will remain as long as our dreams live on. Our days can be made of despair and regrets and deceits that we are not proud of. But remember, my friend, today will soon be gone, but tomorrow will brighten a brand new day. The struggle for a better life is our collective fate. And life offers always an opportunity to reinvent our being. We must not return to the darkness of years past. Our path to the beauty of being together remains illuminating. Thank you very much. And thank you. Thank you for participating and participating with us. And we're going to have the connection with Haiti. We can finish with that if we can get them. I would like to take the opportunity to thank the Cambridge Public Library for providing this venue. Thanks, Professor John Ripton, Steve Hansen, Charles Lucien, Jean-Denis Joachim, Fred Edson Lafortune, Jill Nechensky, Domafis Lafontaine, Roosevelt Deronville, and Daniel George, who was there with us earlier. We will continue to hope for life to fight for life, for the beauty, what I call the beauty of being. And I don't know if we're going to have anything else, but I want to say thank you for coming. Perhaps if anybody wants to say something, maybe we'll have any questions. People want to present. If anybody has any questions, please, to any of us.
I just want to say thank you very much to Tonton Guy. I translated a poem of Tonton Guy's about 4 or 5 years ago, and I've never had a chance to meet him, so we're meeting him for the first time, and that's wonderful. I'm here with a group of 5 global scholar students from Thayer Academy in Braintree, and some of their teachers, and we've been doing a lot of work and a lot of study around Haiti, and it's been a great pleasure to come here and meet some of the Haitian American artists and thinkers and activists who are carrying that torch forward in light of so much pain and suffering after the earthquake. My school, Thayer Academy, is in Braintree, Massachusetts. It's at the end of the red line, and we will be having a Haiti symposium on Thursday, May 18, from 12 midday to 8 p.m. that evening. So keep your calendar open for that date. I'd love to see some of you come down and join us in exploring through panel discussions and through tables and through presentations of art, literature, history, the whole gamut, maybe even a debate on the language question as to whether Creole should be reinstalled as the language of education in Haiti over French. I'm a French teacher and I'm a big fan of that agenda. And we will have several discussions and tables on vectors of health and education in particular, collaborating with some of the organizations around Boston, Summits Education being one, Partners in Health another, St. Rock Haiti Foundation a third, looking at what we can do to move Haiti forward through education and through healthcare delivery in particular. So thank you very much to the organizers of this event for having us.
Mon nom c'est Charles Lucien, là, nous sommes à Cambridge, là, dans la date qui c'est 14 janvier. C'est en commémoration du 7e anniversaire du tremblement de terre. Là. Et groupe ça, qui a fait commémoration ça dans Cambridge Library, nous avons collaboré avec lui comme représentant de l'Assemblée artiste haïtienne en Massachusetts. Donc nous disons ça parce que après le tremblement de terre, là, nous avons fait un voyage dans Jacmel. Nous avons découvert que il y a plusieurs artistes qui étaient perdus, ou bien caillés, ou bien scoumés, ou bien motivation, ou bien open. Donc nous avons commencé en collaboration entre l'Assemblée artiste haïtienne Massachusetts avec l'artiste Jacques Mel. Donc le tableau qui est là-haut, là, c'est Jacques Mel que nous avons cherché pour nous démontrer que l'artiste a exprimé le choc que nous prend, choc physique et choc émotionnel. Pardon. Les tableaux, c'est des tableaux des artistes qui ici dans Boston, Massachusetts, y compris Pam. Mais si vous regardez ça là, c'est parce qu'on a fait une connexion entre choléra qui était venu frapper à Haïti tout dans la même année, tremblement de terre.
Ok, non, Pam, c'est Fred Lafortune, donc moi j'habite Rhode Island. C'est moi-même qui est responsable d'Ecoculture, qui est une organisation culturelle qui a fait promotion pour culture haïtienne, littérature, et l'art, etc. Donc c'était une belle occasion pour nous venir commémorer le 7e anniversaire. Du moins, c'est une question de tremblement de terre là, nous connecter tu en paquet mon en Haïti. Et donc, c'était Tonton Guy avec l'autre collaborateur qui était pour l'initiative là. Tu as gagné une exposition photo, je trouvais qu'il était très bien. Gagné un éditeur, Jemka et Twilingual Press qui était venu faire une sorte de. Mettre le vieux à disposition de monde qui t'a ramené gagné. Donc, c'était vraiment intéressant. Et puis nous avons une prestation de tambour avec Lovel, Jean-Dani Joachim, qui était vraiment intéressant.
Merci Walk. Je suis bien content de découvrir l'activité. C'est une activité pour nous faire parce que nous voulons qu'il y ait une mémoire. Tragédie, c'est ce qu'on a Haïti, qu'il y ait une mémoire vivante. Et tout, porter un petit clarté sur l'effet structurel. Bagaille, accumulage de dégâts qui causé de négligence, exploitation, en contrôle, en relation de dépendance qui fait que Haïti vient tomber dans son sac.
Nom c'est Douma Fils Lafontaine, moi c'est une artiste qui participait dans la commémoration tremblement de terre 12 janvier 2010. Et moi j'ai une série de photos et qui dans photo exhibition ça, j'ai prends en Haïti en février 2010 et quelques semaines après tremblement de terre et ben même avec quelques autres camarades, nous étions en Haïti pour aller porter secours à victimes tremblement de terre. Et puis nous avons pris un petit temps tout et pour nous documenter la dévastation ça que nous quitté devant nous pendant que nous dans le pays. Et bien ça qui est remarquable c'est que nous avons une grande solidarité entre Haïtiens avec Haïtiens. Le phénomène d'insécurité était kaba, ça veut dire que gens nous connaissent plus fort monde, c'est en battant tu as dormi et tout le monde te fait l'autre confiance.